Given the basic nutritional arguments one can make against consuming excess protein, what reasons can paleo promoters find to follow high-protein diets anyway? Well, if it's paleo, there are evolution stories that make it feel right. But that doesn't mean those stories are right. It seems irrelevant what dietary patterns enabled our bigger brains thousands of years ago, but for what it's worth, cooking seems like a better explanation than meat. You've seen this already in my Primal Primates presentation. Here's a more interesting rationale put forth by Cordain for high animal protein consumption in the protein debate. I want to repeat that I find most diet advice based on speculation about evolution to be suspect, as this approach requires an appeal to nature. Humans, he thinks, have a special high meat history that makes us super meat eaters. He says humans have a special adaptation that prevents the overproduction of uric acid, enabling the gorging of meat. His evidence for this is an enzyme called xanthine oxidase. It turns out this xanthine oxidase adaptation did not take place first in humans. We know this mutation took place before we split off from our primate ancestors, as we share it with the great apes. Cordain has his evolutionary history wrong. This is significant. It proves Cordain's argument is only a just-so story. It is not hard science. Just-so stories are a type of ad hoc fallacy. If you doubt my science on this point, here is another reference for this, and another. Our closest relatives, bonobos, chimps, gorillas, and orangutans, eat very little meat, yet they share this mutation. This adaptation was most likely in response to blood pressure regulation in low-salt environments, not high meat intake. Here's another folly of meaty paleo logic. Cordain is aware of a condition called rabbit starvation, which occurs when too much protein is eaten. Serious illness results because of the high metabolic demands of eating meat. He knows there is a maximum amount of protein the kidneys can process. He also says there is only one case in the medical literature of a person eating enough protein to experience this so-called rabbit starvation. He seems to prefer to think of the rarity of this condition as evidence of how hard it is to induce, rather than as evidence that hardly anyone has been crazy enough to try to induce it. By contrast, there are no similar problems with digesting carbohydrates. You can easily eat 80% healthy carbs for years on end and have no adverse health consequences. Moreover, through the last several millennia, the vast majority of humans have eaten high-carb diets, and they were just doing what came naturally. I would think all this would help him realize that humans should not eat high quantities of meat, but somehow he concludes the opposite. He wants us to eat so much meat, we are near the body's limits for metabolizing it safely. By definition, his nutrition beliefs are therefore extreme. We can look at protein and evolution another way. Primitive hunter-gatherers have been said to underutilize lean meats in favor of fat and carbohydrate. This author suggests this may be because high protein can be a problem during pregnancy. You'll see in my Maasai videos that they restrict animal proteins during pregnancy, but they aren't alone. This practice is commonplace among hunter-gatherers. An alternate hypothesis for this is that meat would have raised the chances of exposure to parasites and other pathogens, so women developed an aversion to meat to prevent infections during pregnancy. It's an interesting idea. Cordain's last line of this paragraph from the protein debate is odd. He references a study showing an apparent improvement in gout symptoms due to high protein consumption. This was a pilot study of only 12 people on calorie-restricted diets. He says this study was somehow the proof in the pudding that eating lots of meat is good. Proof in the pudding? He must think this is really compelling. As we have seen, gout is strongly linked to high meat intake for obvious metabolic reasons. So what's the explanation for this one? Well, I've already hinted at it. To preface this, look again at this study. This was a widely referenced article. This is strong epidemiological evidence against high meat diets. By contrast, I haven't seen low protein or vegan diets linked to higher gout risk anywhere. The study he mentions is usually seen as a reflection of the benefits of calorie restriction and weight loss in obese men with gout. Obesity is strongly associated with gout, so once again we see that calorie restriction can improve some chronic diseases. Protein intake was not the only diet variable that changed either. Their whole diet was new. And as I said, this was only 12 people. This study doesn't prove anything, except that this was the best study Cordain could find to confuse you about the link between meat and gout. Discussing protein in the context of evolution brings up the interesting case of a non-human sialic acid called N-glycolylneuraminic acid, or NEU5GC. I'll bet you paleo guys saw this coming. Humans are unique among mammals in that we cannot produce NEU5GC. Ajit Varkey has examined this curious issue. He believes it has implications for human health. He has observed that cancer patients accumulate NEU5GC in their tumors. Since they can't make it themselves, it must come from dietary sources, and those are red meat and dairy. This non-human sialic acid seems to contribute to an inflammatory process in cancer. The inflammation occurs because the immune system recognizes this molecule as foreign. This reminds me a bit of the paleo fears of lectins, but I've never seen that dietary lectins accumulate in cancer tumors for crying out loud. There are numerous toxins associated with meat. Again, imagine the harsh scrutiny being applied to grains and legumes by the paleo people being equally applied to animal protein, and you'll understand why I mention these. First, the National Cancer Institute says exposure to heterocyclic amines and polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons constitutes a risk. These are recognized potential carcinogens produced in well-done meat and meat cooked at high temperatures. Meats are also high in advanced glycation end products, or AGEs, much more so than carbohydrates. AGEs are very bad for you, and this is not in doubt. They might contribute to type 2 diabetes. Here's an in-depth examination of AGEs in different foods. Animal foods did not fare so well. N-nitroso compounds are also well known to be present in processed meats, and they are likely carcinogens. What is less well known is that meats cause these chemicals to be produced inside your body. High meat diets are here compared to smoking tobacco. A typical response to these cooking-related toxins would be to say that meat simply shouldn't be cooked long or at high temperatures, but there is an interesting angle on this for the natural is better paleo belief system. Humans like the taste of these toxic compounds, and we are not alone. Primates like these flavors too, and they don't cook anything. A paleo dieter may wish to eat like his ancestors, but this is not the same as eating for health. In trying to reconcile our attraction to these toxic flavors, it has been suggested that their tastes are reminiscent of some plant foods, and that is why they are preferred by primates like us. Of course, trans fats are naturally found in animal products as well. We all know to avoid trans fats. Animals also bioaccumulate environmental toxins. Packaged meats also are a main route of exposure for xenoestrogens called phthalates. Anti-soy Weston Price fans take note. Another potential area of concern with high animal protein diets is our endocrine function. This study found that whereas some fruits and vegetables appear to improve semen quality, meat and milk might adversely affect it. Amazingly, this has been observed in the male children of mothers who ate a lot of beef. Fish is also suspect in similar ways. It may be that the environmental toxins that concentrate in fish explain its association with poor semen quality. Opposing effects of plant and animal foods have been observed regarding women's fertility as well. Plant protein was better here. Vegetables and meat, including fish, also had opposing effects on stress hormone concentrations during pregnancy. Vegetables were better again. These stress hormone levels apparently remain elevated into the child's adulthood. Those hunter-gatherer women seem to have been onto something. Environmental pollutants are actually more reliable biomarkers of fish consumption than omega-3 fatty acids. This analysis found that the children of mothers who ate more fish had better test scores in spite of the confounding effects of the mercury in the fish. The author's advice was to eat fish lower in mercury to obtain the beneficial nutrients in the fish like omega-3s. It seems to me it would be better still to find sources for these fatty acids that have no mercury. One of the supposed advantages of red meat is its high content of heme iron. I'll look at that issue in part 3.